What's going on, you filthy animals? Gabe here with Buffy Dork. No, this is not a midday report video. This is a short squeeze video. And then we are going to pass along the question, which came first, the chicken or the egg? Answer down in the comment section below. Currently, AMC trading below the 50 and 200 EMA. But what I like to see here, turnover percentage, 4.39%. This is sexy to me. Also, volume, 22.53. That volume? Yeah. We're getting used to seeing these low numbers, and this is something we want to continue seeing. Now, before we look at the Ortex data here, I want to go to the daily, because here we have a wedge. And a lot of people are asking me questions about this as I posted this on Twitter. By the way, if you haven't followed me on Twitter, make sure you do that now. Link down in the description. This is where I give intraday updates on the stock. All right, guys. So we have this wedge here, and we see that the wedge terminates right here at or about November 4th. Now, there's a world of possibility as to the way AMC could move, but it has been respecting this wedge. Currently in this channel, projected trend to the upside can put us past resistance here at about $43.62 into the $44 area at or about October 26. However, the stock market's binary. It can go up or it can go down. So we're looking at this trend here. If it continues to respect this wedge, we would see a move to the downside. And on or about October 26th, we should see AMC playing around the $40 area should it take a turn to the downside. Now, November 4th, this is not a squeeze day. This is not a squeeze prediction. This is basically when we see where AMC really wants to be. Ideally, we want to see her continue respecting this primary trend on the way up. Now, let's go ahead and look at short interest, 16.74%. Max cost to borrow, 3.14%. Now, I want to look at this data here. We talk about having a low volume day. And low volume day attributes to an increase in days to cover for 2 weeks. And that's basically based on 10 trading days. So currently, that number is 2.65. And guys, if we look at when AMC had its run-ups, we have this initial run-up here. And what we see is that days to cover crossed above estimated short interest. And then when it dipped below, we had a run-up. We see the same pattern here where days to cover crosses above estimated short interest, crosses below, and then we had a run-up. Right now, we're looking at a possible convergence. And I'd like to believe that since we crossed to the upside, the next cross to the downside would mean AMC has another run-up. Okay. We got that out of the way. Short interest, 16.74%. Now let's ask the age-old question, which came first, the chicken or the egg? Now, before we get there, let's talk about Berkshire Hathaway. Because if you bought Berkshire Hathaway back in 1990 for at or about $5,890 per share, let's say you bought 10, in 16 years, you would literally be a millionaire. That is an astonishing return on investment. What does this mean? Well, you know, we talk about AMC being a short squeeze play, but the common denominator is supply and demand. That's essentially what this is. We buy up enough shares to pin the shorts, and there's not enough supply to meet their demand to cover, hence the squeeze. But stocks don't need short interest to go up, as evident in Berkshire Hathaway. It's supply and demand. Now, Warren Buffett has gone on record in stating that he did not want his Class A shares being manipulated, speculated, or day traded. Thus, outstanding shares have been kept low, and he had not seen any stock splits. Supply and demand dictates the price, period. So as we continue to buy, and people continue to want the stock because the stock keeps on running, you know what happens first? Hold on to that thought. Comment down in the comments below. The question I have to ask you, if supply and demand is the true play, which I believe it is, what happens first? Do the shorts cover or do we continue buying and holding and buying as I've said to do over the past 10 months, creating enough buying pressure, which then brings in FOMO, and then the FOMO becomes the catalyst to cause the squeeze. Where I think FOMO is probably going to yield more price action than the short squeeze. In fact, if we cover the SEC report as Ranch Capital did, and I love that guy, what we gathered from that report was no one covered. What was the major catalyst? Was it a gamma squeeze? They theorize mostly FOMO. FOMO is what's going to set us free. But in order for other people to pay attention or take notice, we need to continue to buy and hold. The FOMO is what's going to catalyze the short squeeze. So hence, people are treating this play as if the short squeeze catalyzes the FOMO. It doesn't work that way. But how do we get to FOMO? And that's what we need to start thinking first. We get to FOMO by buying and holding and making sure that day traders, institutions do not have enough shares to trade on the intraday. Because as I said yesterday in yesterday's video, these guys are making an absolute killing. In fact, in other plays and in other equities, that's how I make my daily bread. It's what I do to sustain my living. Whether AMC has elevated short interest or it doesn't, we need to continue the buying pressure. Because let's assume that the shorts cover tomorrow. Yes, that will be a catalyst to FOMO, but we actually want it the other way around. Because if FOMO comes first, then the shorts have to cover at a much higher price. And that's what we want. I know there's a lot of young investors out there. Actually, Wrench Capital highlighted from the SEC report that there's been a major influx of average age 19-year-olds who are now in the markets. And that is a beautiful thing to see. However, there's somewhat of a generational divide here. And I know that my ideology doesn't appeal to, you know, the youngsters, the 19-year-olds, the Instagrammers, the instant fame. I'm a long and steady ones to raise kind of guy. What I would like to keep in check is our expectations, especially from the younger investors that are in this play. This is a long game. As long as we play it right, and as long as we don't get caught up in so many different narratives, yes, we can speculate about synthetics. Yes, we could speculate FTDs. We could speculate everything. Shit, I could speculate your grandma's bra size. The truth is, we get back to the basics, and we buy and we hold and we buy some more. Everything else just falls into place. Mathematics does not lie. We make the stock a scarcity and the number goes up. This is Gabe. I'm signing out. Make sure you guys like, share, subscribe. You know what to do. Peace!